So with respect to this, there are some very powerful lines in Seven Dalai Lama's writing, in one of which he says that just as in a mind that is intoxicated with sleep, various events and objects arises in that dream, and that, you know, just as and just as they appear so real in that dream. However, the reality of what all the things that appear in the dream is that they cannot be demonstrated to be real. They are unreal. In the same manner, he says that in our everyday perceptions, when things appear to our mind, they appear to possess as if they possess inherent existence, just like as if our mind, our perceptions are intoxicated by this grasping at inherent existence. However, the perceptions that we have of things possessing objective existence is unfounded. And even though this is the case, So
he
says that even though they do not possess any reality at all, but to the mind, the sixfold consciousness of ordinary sentient beings, which are intoxicated by the deep sleep of delusion, they, each of these things appear as if each of them possess a self-defining reality of their own, as if existing in their own right objectively from outside. So he says that for the ordinary mind, when we perceive something outside, we perceive that phenomena as if existing right there from the side of the object itself. And so therefore he says that so this distorted perception, so the content of that distorted perception, which assumes that things to possess some kind of objective existence in their own right, and this is the subtle object of negation, and this must be negated without any residue, without leaving anything anything behind. And then similarly, Khungdang Rinpoche says in one of his writings, in Khungdang Rinpoche's writing, he says that through the cultivation of the view of emptiness, one seeks to understand the nature of things. However, in that process, one does not find inherent existence. And that not finding inherent existence through this process constitutes the negation of inherent existence. So generally, not finding something is not equivalent to negating something or finding its non-existence. But in the context where if it is something that when we search for it, it should be findable, yet when we search for it, if it cannot be found, then in such context, then non-observance or non-finding and finding its non-existence coincide. So in the case of inherent existence, if it is real, when we search for it, it should be findable. So when you, through emptiness reasoning, when you do not find it, you are negating the inherent existence. And then he says that, however, that does not reject, that does not imply the non-existence of the basis upon which you understand emptiness. So the designated bases are left untouched. And so the only reality that one can affirm in the aftermath is the nominal existence. So only a mere label and mere designation. And it is on that level of nominal existence one should be able to accord all the functions of cause and effect and so on. And the fact that the functions operate and they exist, and the relationships and functions still exist, is something that will be affirmed through one's own personal experience of the world. And if one follows this line of processes, then Kung Dang says that one has arrived at the right point. And so when talking about subjecting inherent existence to critical analysis and not finding it, and this process may involve the application of or employment of fivefold reasoning of identity, absence of identity, difference, basis and the support and the supported, and inherent relations that we find in Nagarjuna's text. And if we add two more, the shape or configuration and the collection, then it becomes a sevenfold analysis. So when you subject person or self to this kind of fivefold or sevenfold analysis, and when you do not find that, because if, say, for example, person do exist objectively in its own right, then when you search for it, it should exist either as identical with the aggregates, or as separate, or as a support, or as a supported. However, when you search through such analysis, we do not find it. And that is an indication that the person do not exist objectively in its own right. So, and once objective existence becomes untenable, then the other option left is the subjective existence. And then the subjective existence also becomes a problem, because then you will have to identify the existence of something, you know, in terms of one's own state of mind. So therefore, neither the subjective existence or objective existence becomes tenable. So the only alternative that is left is the nominal existence. So you accord existence to phenomena only in nominal terms.